approaches. Connecticut is strategically located between New York and Boston in the heart of the rich northeastern market. It's a state of dynamic economic growth, rich in variety and full of opportunity. The name of Stanley Tools is synonymous with the hardware city of New Britain. This redevelopment site, adjacent to rail, provides land for future industrial expansion in the New Britain area. The south central part of our state is centered around New Haven and Long Island Sound. The city green in New Haven, with its colonial churches, is surrounded by the central business area. Yale University's new epidemiology laboratory and science center have given its traditional campus a modern look. On autumn Saturdays, the Bulldogs of Old Ely perform in the Yale Bowl. The older areas of New Haven are the scene of some of the most extensive redevelopment projects in the entire United States. New commercial buildings are arising here. New expressways, such as Interstate 91, facilitate the flow of traffic in and out of the city. In the foreground, Interstate Route 95 curves about New Haven Harbor. Next to it is the Long Wharf redevelopment project, where Sargent Hardware has constructed this plant on a site which was once swamp and wasteland. The Schick Safety Razor Company is conveniently located adjacent to the Connecticut Turnpike at Milford. This area, extending from Milford to West Haven, is a growing industrial and distribution center. And Superior Industries, Enthone, Nabisco, and Fisher Wines have located production facilities and warehouses here. These industries are also served by the New York, New Haven, and Hartford Railroad, which provides freight and passenger service to all major cities. 1,000 acres of this area, next to Interstate 91 in Wallingford, is planned as a research park by two of Connecticut's major electric utilities. In Old Saybrook, the R.R. Donnelly Company prints Life and Time for Eastern distribution at a plant convenient to rail and turnpike. The Kramer Division of Giannini Controls, which produces timing devices, has also located in this shoreline town. The historic Connecticut River is the state's largest navigable waterway. Essex is one of many villages which offer sheltered coves for yachts and pleasure boats. It's a major recreational resource, and shad, the poor man's salmon, provides excellent sport during the annual spring spawning run. Middletown, with its wide main street, is a typical New England college town, home of Wesleyan University, a liberal arts college of highest academic standards. At East Haddam, the Goodspeed Opera House, a showplace of the 18th century, continues to provide cultural entertainment in a setting only a few miles removed from this 20th century nuclear electric generating facility of 500,000 kilowatts. The southeastern part of Connecticut is typically New England in appearance. The white lighthouse, sand, and water along its shoreline are part of this region's immutable image. Long Island Sound offers unlimited opportunities for outdoor recreation. Rocky Neck State Park is one of the many facilities available for public enjoyment. Offshore, sailboat racing is a popular pastime, as is deep sea fishing for such prizes as tuna and swordfish. Charles W. Morgan is a famous whaler of yesteryear, preserved as part of the state's cultural heritage at the world-famous Mystic Marine Museum. The Connecticut College for Women typifies the educational opportunities found here. The city of New London is the commercial center of this region, as well as a deep water port and the southern terminus of the Central Vermont Railway. Across the Thames River at Groton are the home base and training facilities of the Atlantic Submarine Fleet.
This is the entrance to our nation's largest submarine base, and the largest submarine base in the free world. In 1867, the state of Connecticut gave the U.S. Navy this tract of land along the Thames River. But it wasn't until 50 years later that the former coaling station and training base gained importance as a submarine base.
Downriver, the electric boat division of General Dynamics constructs atomic-powered submarines such as the Nautilus, Skate, and Seawolf. Here also, Charles Pfizer and Company conducts medical research and produces pharmaceuticals and biologicals. Upriver at Ledyard, a division of the Dow Chemical Company manufactures plastic materials. And the Davis and Standard division of Crompton, Knowles and Stonington produces plastic forming machinery. The city of Norwich, at the head of the navigation of the Thames River, serves the northern part of this region. Graduates of the State Vocational Technical School and the Thames Valley Technical Institute, both of which are located here, are an important source of technically educated workers for industries such as the American Thermos Division of King Sealy and the Federal Paperboard Company's 170,000 square foot plant in Sprague. The northeastern part of our state is rich in land resources. Rolling countryside, dotted with orchards and farms, provides a pleasant setting for the tourist's camera. Agricultural pursuits in this area include dairying, poultry raising, and general farming. The Pomfret School is typical of Connecticut's 72 private secondary and preparatory schools, which include Choate, Hotchkiss, Taft, and Loomis. Nearby at Storrs, more than 10,000 students are enrolled at the University of Connecticut, whose campus includes modern, well-equipped facilities for graduate work and research. This area also has a variety of industrial pursuits. The Todd Division of Barrows Incorporated prints checks and forms at this plant in Tolland. The Jones and Laughlin Steel Company has located a branch plant at Willimantic, a city often referred to as the thread capital of the United States. Putnam is a northeastern Connecticut industrial center where a subsidiary of the Paul Corporation manufactures coated papers. At Plainfield, ceramic bathroom fixtures are produced in this facility of the American Radiator and Standard Sanitary Products Company. The Knox Glass Company's branch plant at Dayville manufactures glass containers from Connecticut silica sand and limestone. This is the only glass container plant in New England, and it has expanded continually to meet the requirements of this regional market. Connecticut is the home of industries which have become famous over the years for the quality and reliability of their products. It has also become the home for branch plants of many well-known out-of-state industries. While the factors which make a state a good location for industry are many and varied, one thing is certain. Where industry has succeeded, new industry can likewise grow and prosper. This has long been true of Progressive Connecticut.
Good evening, everybody. everybody. Welcome to the Wheel of Freedom, the 60s. And look who we brought back.
Oh, yeah.
We have the retro. My name is Phil Marie, and we got Coach Kopaczynski from the 1960s, Wally.
Yep, those were good years.
Huh?
Those were good years for me. As far as with the film that people just watched, I think everybody in the state will find something in there that they know about, you know what
sure.
I mean, what happened. As far as New Britain is concerned, I grew up in New Britain, and I worked for a factory in New Britain before I went to the Army, and it was very successful. New Britain was considered the hardware city of the world. That's how many factories they had there. That's how many. Now they only have about three or four. I don't think even there's that many.
Stanley Tools is still there.
Well,
holding and hanging on.
Yeah, well, they're moving out. They're moving out a little slowly but surely. They're going. But I remember I used to sell Kool-Aid and try to sell it to the guys who were coming out of the factory in the hot summer months, you know. And but New Britain was a swinging town. And it's just too bad that we lost so much of our industry in the whole country. And I don't know how our politicians allowed that. And I think our politicians wanted that to happen too. And that all came out with President Clinton when he starts sending all the businesses out of the country. And that didn't help this country at all.
Yeah, well,
and
NAFTA started.
That's Clinton.
Yeah, because I remember years ago with the tile.
Yeah.
Most tile was all made in America.
Yeah.
And if it was an import tile from Italy mostly or Spain,
yeah.
You had to wait weeks and weeks for it.
Yeah.
And it was more expensive. Today, it's the complete opposite.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hardly any tile is made in America anymore. And I forgot that box top again. A United States ceramic tile company made in China.
Right. We're still the largest business company in the world. Our country is. We do more business than anybody else. But Trump is turning around and he's making it better. He's going to make it better. That's what I like about that.
It's a lot of work, man.
Oh, yeah. But he's being fought by everybody. Even Republicans are fighting him because they don't want him. They don't want him because he's afraid. They're afraid that he's going to change their position and their power structure.
Yep.
And that's got to stop. They got to wake up and do something about that.
What was that comment about Colt Arms? You said you almost worked there for Colt?
Oh, yeah. When I got out of the Army, I was the company armor. I was in charge of all the weapons.
Yeah.
I had to take guys on fire machine guns and rocket launchers and all that stuff. And I had to teach them how to fire their guns and how to clean them and all that stuff. And so when I came out of the Army, I thought I could get a job at Colt Arms. They wanted to give me a job, but I didn't want to go on assembly line. And I eventually went someplace else. I got a job with Kraft Foods. And that worked out well for me. And they were tough, but, you know, to inspire you, they either hit you on the head or they treat you nice. They pat you on the bottom, you know.
Sure, sure.
But
how did that feel when they patted you on the bottom? Did
well,
you like it?
It was good. It was
okay,
good, you know.
Yeah. It was
but,
a nice pat.
I was there for 28 years with them, and I retired early. But the 60s were great. I love the 60s because I was in the service, and that's when I grew up. I grew up in the service. And I tell you what, not to fight in a war, but it's a good way for anybody to grow up. And that's what young people need sometimes. Get away from your friends in your neighborhood and join the military.
Sure.
You know,
sure.
Of course, we don't want to go into war, but you could learn a lot of things. And that's where I grew up and that's what I learned. I learned how to read and things like this. You know, I couldn't go to college or anything because we had 10 kids in the family and we had no money. So that's one of the reasons I went into service.
Yeah, we've shared a lot of stories, not necessarily on the air, but as far as growing up poor,
yeah.
pretty much. And,
you
know, you learn how to make ends meet with very little, if that's all you got.
Well, sometimes we had so little food the cockroaches were starving to death.
That's
so we'll
different.
See. Yeah.
So, anyways, we have some cool videos tonight: TV shows, music, sports. The Boston Patriots, Boston Red Sox, 60's, all 60's. But Wally has some interesting stuff, which I did not get into any news stories or the political, especially politics on tonight, but I was born in 65. So I was more interested in like the TV shows, like Magilla Gorilla, Casper the Ghost. I wasn't into the news part, so why don't we take a few minutes, Wally, with the news, if you want. Do you want to get into some of that stuff? I didn't cover any of it, like the, what was it, the Kennedys or the Great Society? You got some stuff there that I did not get into, and if you want to, or we can go into the TV shows video.
As far as the movie actors, you want me to bring up them? Or you got that
wait
goes
till,
to one of the films.
Exactly. Wait till we okay. do the TV shows.
And as far as what's going on, politics, in 1964, President Johnson took over for the assassinated Kennedy. And he passed some laws here to help spread the Great Society. You know, where we start giving Medicare and Medicaid to people and more health, more money to help them to be successful.
Sure.
And the bill never would have passed if it wasn't for the Republicans, because most of the Democrats from the South refuse to help our black Americans. They didn't want them to get all these benefits and all that stuff. But the Republicans voted, almost all of the Republicans voted for them. That bill got passed, and that was one of the great things for the Great Society.
So you were a Democrat back then, correct?
I was a Democrat, right.
Okay.
Yeah, I was a delegate for
record,
a little while.
That's,
yeah.
That's right.
But one of the bad things, I don't know if you want me to bring up the war at all, but we had...
You can, a couple minutes, okay. Wally. Sure,
yeah,
sure.
Well, we had the war in Vietnam, and It was taking a lot of money away from the poverty programs because we need to support the troops in Vietnam. And there was a lot of Americans. This is when the far left was taking over the colleges like they are now. And people took off for Canada. They refused to honor our soldiers. They refused to go into the military. And instead, they ran away and went to Canada. I was hoping those people never came back. I just don't care. I don't care how they felt about the war, but what they did, somebody took their place, and maybe they got killed because of that, because these people refused to join the military, and that was completely wrong. And we have some people who went into politics after that. The colleges were having, they were bad. They were getting taken over by the far left. And we had some bad things that happened on these colleges too, where the college students were rioting there, and they had to bring in troops to close them down. And what happened was some National Guard people who were frightened for their lives, some fired, one person probably shot the rifle off, and then everybody opened fire up, and some students got killed. But that's because of the protesters.
I was watching the a lot of different stuff on the 60s, Wally, and I told you about this. I was amazed at the similarities, the protest, the violence, and holding signs that said resist. I couldn't believe it. Yeah. It was like looking at today, but back in the 60s.
Yeah.
And so we may have to do another show sometime, because it was an awful lot about the Black Panthers, a lot of stuff that really happened here in Connecticut that I was amazed. But we only have an hour, and it's so hard to touch some of this. So anyways, what's up with the Kennedys, Wally? What happened there?
Because what happened was in the 60s.
Or how do you remember that, basically? I should ask.
Well, I know that President John Kennedy got assassinated, his brother got assassinated, and Martin Luther King got assassinated. That's all in the 60's. And that's terrible, terrible, terrible. You know, and it changed our lives a lot. Jack Kennedy, he took over for President Eisenhower, and President Eisenhower was going to overthrow Cuba. And Kennedy went along with it, but then in the last few hours, he stopped all air support to go into Cuba. So the Cubans who wanted their own country to fight Castro, they got all shot up by the Cubans, and Castro took over the country for good. And that's sad. And I'll tell you what, President Trump is changing whatever Barack Obama done, because we were going to forgive Castro all their bad deeds, and they're not asking them to get better things and help the Cuban people. They need help, the Cuban people, and that's one of the reasons Trump does not want our businesses to go in there, because the people who are going to get all the support and all the money is the military in Cuba, and that's what he's against. Now, the businesses in this country are going to be upset because they want more business, and that's their job, to get more business. But from what I understand, Trump's not going to allow that. He's not going to allow that, and it's good. In my opinion, that's good. We shouldn't help him.
So I'm going to say this a couple times tonight. I hope you come back. Maybe once every couple months, once every, I don't know, whatever you feel like. But there's a lot more to talk about, even with the 60s. But we do have some cool other videos with TV shows. I mean, what a great time to for television. I mean, the TV shows are amazing, Wally. I couldn't believe you guys are going to like probably three quarters of these shows. Just Wally, it just goes on and on and on, and I was amazed at like how good those TV shows were compared to today.
Well,
and you only had a few channels to watch.
What I remember, and I hated it, we had antennas, and a lot of people have never seen antennas. They don't know what they did. We used to have to go up on a roof and turn the antennas so that they could pick up the pictures and everything else. And I was always a joke in the neighborhood, because I always put a chair up on top of the roof.
Oh, so you could sit there and
turn
it? Cool.
And then my wife would go look and see if the picture was clearer and everything else, and then she'd yell up. We didn't have the cell phones in those days either.
So. Well, it's 7:24. I say we get that TV shows video going, and I want all the viewers, talk about a ride down memory lane. This is amazing how good all these shows were. Let's run that video, please.
And it's time now for American Bandstand.
The Beverly Hillbillies.
Show. 54, where are you?
Come along, everybody, to the new Casper cartoon.
From the skin cap on the top of old Ben to the heel of his rawhide shoes.
They call him Flipper, Flipper, faster than lightning.
Step two.
Green Acres is the place to be.
Gunsmoke, with Milburn Stone as Doc.
Jeopardy. And now, here's the star of Jeopardy, Art Fleming.
Good morning.
Meet George Jetson.
The FBI.
A horse is a horse, of course, of course, and no one can talk to a horse, of course.
Television set.
But they're cousins, identical cousins all the way.
Want you to meet the family known as the real McCoy.
Petticoat Junction.
Rolling, 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 though the strings are swollen.
Johnny Umar was a rebel. He roamed through the West.
The Rifleman.
Hey!
Spider-Man does whatever a spider can. Spins a web any size.
Before.
That's the signpost up ahead. Your next stop, the Twilight Zone.
The Untouchables. A Desi Lu production. To the Bottom of the Sea, starring Richard Basehart.
The wonderful world of colors.
Yogi Bear.
Nothing wrong with your television set.
Over here, turn the light, and oh, what hearts we'll hit. On with the show, this is it.
All right. All right. Wally.
Great, great movies. TV programs. Yeah.
How many of those did you... Well, obviously you didn't watch cartoons. You weren't that young.
No.
But I did. I mean, the cartoons, all that, and some of the shows. What was your favorite show? I noticed you got Dick Van Dyke, Ed Sullivan, The Rifleman.
I liked them all. I didn't have a real favorite one and all that stuff, but I enjoyed it. You know, and as far as movie actors are concerned and everything else, I got a whole list here of who were big in the 60s, and I'm sure the customers out there, people out there will be watching this, and they'll know them all, like John Wayne, and he's number one on the list. Doris Day, who was a singer and an actress, and then we got Elizabeth Taylor. Elizabeth Taylor, I was looking at an article today. She's married eight times, yeah.
She had some high mileage.
Yeah, I know it. She, she kept a lot of people happy anyhow, you know what I mean? And then I heard on a program today that how she made more money in her jewelry that she has than she made in the movies. She made more money that way. She was like a billionaire after that. She was a billionaire that. But then we had Gary Grant, who was very popular. Then you had Rock Hudson, who was very popular. And, of course, there was Jack Lemmon. And then there was Paul Newman, who was big time. And then we had Julie Andrews and Elvis Presley and Sean Connery and Sandra Dee. And then we had Lee Marvin. Lee Marvin was a war veteran of the Second World War. I think he fought in the South Pacific. And he got wounded. He was there. He got wounded. And then we had Steve McQueen, who was very, very popular at the time. And Sidney Poitier was also very important. And then, of course, you had Jerry Lewis, who was a comedian, with Dean Martin. Remember, he used to be a partner with Dean Martin, and then they broke up.
And then Frank Sinatra in there?
Yeah.
With Dean Martin.
But that was good, and they were very happy. They were very happy with that. But we also had, at the time, in the 60s, Marilyn Monroe was very, very popular. Matter of fact, Robert Kennedy and Jack Kennedy kind of liked her a little bit, and they used to go visit her to encourage her to have a good time. But We also had, in 62, we had the Cuban Missile Crisis, when the United States was in trouble with the Russians and all that stuff. But you look around here and you say, what's going on, you know? And there's a lot of successful people over there, a lot of successful. As far as sports people are concerned, we're not going to talk about that today?
We decided, and good thing Wally agreed already, so you guys, we can hold him to it. He's going to come back. We're going to do a whole show on sports, looking back through sports.
And I can talk about my sports, right?
Yeah, because this is way too much stuff for 1 hour. It's impossible. We can cover, as it is, some of the videos I don't even think we can get to. But as long as you want to come back, and we can do a look back at sports, and including your softball Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
So, and I have a stuff on that video, you know, we did, I don't know, years ago.
Yeah.
And so we're going to save the sports stuff for another show, whenever you want to come back. But we have music, and there's something about music, Wally. Just something about music.
Bill Haley and his Comets.
Huh? 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock. It'll rock around the clock tonight. Hey,
here we go. Walter's ready.
Oh yeah, I was, I liked those dances.
Did you used to dance like that?
Oh yeah.
Huh?
Yep.
You went in dance like that?
Well, you know, when I went in the Army, I never danced. But, you know, I've seen all the guys are taking the girls out on dates and all that, and I don't know how to dance. So I went and faked it, how to dance and everything. And before you know it, I learned how to dance. Oh yeah, I did all that, man.
Really? Do you remember that at the drive-in there with the
food? Yeah, I did all that. Yeah.
Yeah? Good stuff, Walter. Yeah.
That's the 60s, my friend.
That is the 60s, huh? When the chimes ring 5, 6, and 7.
I used to have so much fun dancing. Guys would ask their if I would dance with their wives. That's what they used to
really?
Ask me, honest to God.
You were that good? You were a swinger.
Oh, yeah.
Back then, that was a swinger.
Yeah, now I can hardly walk. Oh, I did all that stuff.
Is that you right there dancing?
Oh, yeah, I did that stuff.
That looks like you. You and Ann, actually. Is this?
Ann was a good dancer. Ann is a good dancer, too.
I can picture you guys.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Like those moves?
Well, she was in college when I met her, so. That's Bill Haley in the Comets. That's what that is.
Bill Haley.
And I know these people, they remember him too.
Good stuff.
This is a big hit. This was a big hit.
Sing it, Walter.
There we go.
Sing it, Walter. That's great.
Yeah.
I tell you what, rock around the clock, Wally. You got the moves.
That was a big hot. That was a
so
big
hot. We got like, what, 15 minutes left. Now that we got into the music a little bit, we have the top 10 music artist or whatever.
Are they little clips that you could show?
Yeah, just
I think the people would like to see that.
A series of that, so I think we ought to get into that with the with the music video, and then we'll take it from there.
But I would like to hear it, yeah.
Oh, of course. Reg, can we get that music video rolling, please?
This decade was defined by the evolution of rock and roll into more diverse genres, as well as the rise of pop, heavy metal, funk, soul, and R&B.
Man thinks about a little bit of baby girl and a baby boy.
Welcome to WatchMojo.com, and today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 musical acts of the 1960s. For our series on the top 10 musical acts per decade, we've based our choices on a mix of an act's success, popularity, and overall musical legacy.
When you ain't got nothing, you got nothing to lose.
This is part of a series of videos spanning the decades of music from the 1950s to the 2000s.
Where no man has gone.
10. The Temptations.
You gotta smile so bright.
Known for having a lineup of at least 5 male singers and dancers, as well as their association with the legendary Motown Records, this American group was a hit-making machine during the 1960s. Like their fellow Motown counterparts, the Supremes. The Temptations churned out smash after smash. While that decade saw My Girl become one of their most lasting hits, they also made waves in the 70s with Papa Was a Rolling Stone. Still makes music today, though only one original member, Otis Williams, remains.
Wherever he laid his hat was his home. And when he died, only the hymn was alone.
Number 9, The Who. Part of the British invasion which took control of the American music scene in the 1960s, this rock band personified the pervasive feeling of youthful rebellion.
Die before I get old. I get my generation.
Number 8, James Brown. When it comes to putting on a killer live show, it didn't get much better than when the Godfather of Soul stepped onto the stage. Influencing many genres, especially funk and soul, James Brown built a furious reputation night after night.
So good, so good. I got you.
His signature dance moves were a major influence on Michael Jackson, while remarkable tunes like Papa's Got a Brand New Bag and I Got You, I Feel Good have become pop culture milestones.
So nice, so nice. I got you.
R-E-S-P-C-T. Find out what it means to me.
Number 7, Aretha Franklin.
Take F-T-C-T. Suck it to me, suck it to me, suck it.
The Queen of Soul started her career as a gospel singer for her minister father's church. Things soon turned around once Columbia Records discovered the Memphis-born teen's astonishing talent. Number 6, The Doors.
Know that it will be untrue. Know that I would be
a... Led by charismatic bad boy Jim Morrison, this Los Angeles rock band created a unique, organ-driven sound that was carried by the frontman's deep, unaltered... Number 5, Bob Dylan. By bringing lyrical depth to pop music and proving how substance-filled a simple pop song could be, Number 4, The Jimi Hendrix Experience. California-based group took barbershop music and R&B and added them to 50s rock and roll to produce the five-part vocal harmonies and surf rock sound they're now known for. Number 2, The Rolling Stones.
I see my riddle and I want it painted black.
Formed in 1962, this long-lasting band is still kicking it to this day, even though its members are over 65 years old.
I see the
so high, just empties on the floor.
Countless hits, groundbreaking LPs, and a level of success so insane it was dubbed Beatlemania. It's not surprising that the Fab Four tops our list of musical acts of the 1960s.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away.
I like the Beatles. I like Elvis Presley.
He likes the Beatles.
And Elvis. I loved Elvis,
right,
too. Yeah.
You loved Elvis. That's
and you know what? Elvis was a wonderful singer when he went to religious songs. He did a gospel music. He was outstanding.
I was enjoying some of that. Yeah. Saturday I was
is that
checking
right?
him out. Yeah,
but he
yeah.
destroyed himself, which is sad. You know what I mean? And that's what happens with a lot of these type of people. They get into drugs, man, and they screw things up, man. It's too bad. It's very sad.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, overall, to be a little bit moralistic, people are dying too much on drugs, man. Something's got to be done.
Back then and now.
It's worse now. It's worse now.
It's crazy. But Motown was my favorite, no doubt. Temptations, Smokey Robinson.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Al Green. What's the other ones?
I liked Four.
Marvin Gaye.
Well, Four Coins. You ever hear of them? The Four Coins. The Platters.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah, I like them.
Platters, well, sure.
And,
how about Marvin Gaye? Right.
Marvin Gaye was wonderful.
Marvin Gaye.
But did he, you said his father killed him.
His father shot him.
Oh, boy.
In 19, was it 74 or 84?
Well, I don't know.
I don't remember. But it was, his parents were in an argument, and he got in the middle of it, and his old man put two bullets in him and killed him.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow,
Marvin Gaye. One of the best ever.
That's sad.
Best ever. So... And then speaking of musicians, which Wally, you gave me your copy. I had it. I had two copies, and I cannot. I have them somewhere. But the show we did with Lloyd Price here.
Yep.
We had Lloyd Price in here. But Reg, I'm going to go to camera three here real quick.
There he is.
Yeah, huh? He sat right in here with us.
Yep. And he was a nice man. He was a nice man. Was that his big hit?
Yeah.
Personality.
Sing it, Wally.
I don't remember all the
back to us, Reg. What do you say, Wally? 5 minutes left.
I'm enjoying the program.
Huh?
I'm enjoying the program.
Whoa, 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 Wally.
Hey.
Huh? Yeah, Lloyd Price. I was very fortunate to...
get a hold of him. Yeah, how'd you make a connection with him?
I met a gentleman from New York that I actually did work for, and we ended up good friends, and he coincidentally was good friends with Lloyd Price.
And if I remember, he drove in from New York, and he went home that night to New
York.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. But he was at, we were at a cookout together that Sunday before, so I was hanging out with him like for hours.
Oh, okay.
He's a neat guy. So Wally, we got 4 minutes left.
Yeah.
Excuse me. So we didn't even get to the, well, we did pretty good, though. We did good. We got three of the videos of Wally. But what can a buck get you? Remembering what a buck could buy in the 60s,
yeah,
Wally.
I know, huh? I know.
Gas? How much was gas in the 60s?
18 cents a gallon.
Well, I see 31 cents, 31, yeah. And it went up to 35 cents in 1969. How about that?
You know, the gas prices have gone down by 12 cents. It was like $5. No, what was it? What was the gas prices? But it was like 12 cents less. The prices have dropped. And how much have the price of gasoline charged?
You know. Well, Connecticut, as they keep adding taxes, yeah, as gas drops down. When, yeah, gas goes back up, Connecticut, we're going to be one of the highest, always going to be the, yeah, highest. So, yeah, anyways, but a gallon of milk, 95 cents. Back in the 60s, in 1965, 95 cents. That means milk hasn't, yeah, really gone up that much. You can still get a gallon for like $2.99 or something.
What? Okay.
So a dozen eggs, 53 cents. Heinz ketchup bottle, 22 cents. 1 ounce Hershey bar, 5 cents. Pillsbury cake mix, 25 cents. A pound of pork chops. Pound of pork chops. $1.03. Pound of sirloin steak, 85 cents. And a six pack of Pepsi, 59 cents, Wally.
Wow.
59 cents. And then it goes into razor blades, toiletries, all that stuff. But then again, what were you making back then, Wally?
Well, after I got married, I think I was making $4,000 a year.
Well, then, all right. then a loaf of bread, all right. You're still eating bread and butter to make ends meet. So we only got a minute left.
Yeah.
Man, this thing sped right by.
Well, you know what you could do with this? When your shows, you know, if I'm not here, that's all right, no problem. You could spend a couple minutes on this.
Yeah,
you know,
well, I got...
And just bring it back with the people, and they'll be more than glad to hear it.
I have, and I have plenty to stew on. I thought next week we're not doing a show because it's July 4th, but as of right now, I think the studio is open, so I may be here next week. If not, I'll be here the following week. And desperately want to get Kirk Wiebe, Bill Binney on, NSA whistleblowers. There's some big stuff going on and so forth. But I have a lot to talk about. I didn't want to get into any of it tonight. I wanted to have fun with Walter. So whether or not next week I'm live or not, I'm not sure, but if we're not live, you'll see this show running again.
Okay.
So, and we're starting to fade out. And Wally, so fun having you back. And we're going to do another show. We're going to get Wally back to do a look back into sports over the years. So keep that in mind. That's our next show. Because Wally's only coming back to do fun stuff, correct? He's had enough of Obama and everything else. Done deal. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
God bless all the viewers. God bless America. Wally, last word?
What's the last word?
I don't know. That's it. He said the last word.
Listen up.
Right. Good night.
Good night.